humor you got there. All right. Thank you so much. Well, hey, everybody.
Hello.
There you go. All right. It is an honor and a privilege to be in the great, great city of Cortland, New York. And to those of you that are here today to honor our troops because you love America. Way to go, amigos. That's right, sir. I speak Mexican. Feliz Navidad. My llama is Jorge Bush. And to those of you that enjoy this freedom that we all hold so dear, mi casa is su casa. But to those that would challenge our freedom, I'll use a little Mexican food lingo and say, mi casa is nachos. Let me see if I can get this to quit making jittery noises so it's not a distractification. Not long. Is that better?
Good.
See, because it's not about me. See, that's the thing. It's not about me. It's about we.
Amen.
It's about America.
Yes.
It's about this family that we all share together. Good times, bad times, employed, unemployed. We are one nation under God.
Amen. Amen.
And we are indivisible. Oh, they can try. I remember a day not too long ago when I was reading a little story down in Sarasota, Florida. And they knocked down a couple of our buildings. We've already rebuilt it. Now, don't get me wrong. They changed a lot of lives. They poured a lot of rain out that day. But America came back stronger because of Americans, because of the spirit upon which this nation was founded. And I couldn't be more proud to be with my friends here in Cortland today. And so, again, thank you so much. Mr. Mayor, would you stand and let's just greet our wonderful Mayor, Brian. Appreciate you so much. You know, and I thought, see, something about a toe. See, I know how my fingers have been, but how have my toes been? COVID. So there you go. So that's how I do stuff. When you care about folks, you take the time to work them into your schedule, work them into your life. And when people are generous, that's how good things happen. And so we are here today to honor some folks, and we're going to do it. But I can't begin without first honoring the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You know, somebody asked me one time what kind of difference my father made. And I said, are you kidding? My father made me. And that's true in both the physical and the other way, you know. He made us. And so without him, we wouldn't even be here. And that's kind of a duh. But some people don't get it, you know what I mean? Like there have been things that I had took a while to learn. They were no-brainers, but I still didn't get it. What's that say? So the next person I think I've got to acknowledge is my beautiful bride, Laura. Oh, oh. Every time I hear her voice, my heart just goes pity-pat. You know what? I love her like the day I met her. You know, when I first met Laura, she was a librarian. That's why I checked her out in the first place. She prays for me. She listens to me. I think she even voted for me. And she herself is a great, generous, and giving American, and not someone to be trifled with. I'll tell you a little story that'll illustrate it. She was with me. You know, we're flying out of Washington, D.C. for the last time. D.C., I like it. I like that its name was initials. It makes it easy to remember. Easy to spell. D.C., you know, like Diet Coke. Only, of course, it's District of Columbus. You know. So anyway, we had the plane, Air Force One. Oh, boy. Now, that's a man cave right there. We had Air Force One drop us off at the border of Texas, and we had my F-150 waiting for us there, because I couldn't wait to get that Texas dust back up in my lungs, you know? And so Laura and I are tooling down the road and talking and chatting over the last 8 years, and we stopped in Waco to gas her up with some flex fuel. And I had forgotten to get my wallet back from the Secret Service courts, you know? Oh, by the way, how do y'all like my Secret Service agents? That's all Obama would give me. They mean business, Phil. I had to borrow them from their day job modeling formations. Anyway, so Laura, I had to have her pay for the gas because, like I said, I hadn't gotten my credentials back. And so, Laura goes in there. She's in there about 30 seconds. She sticks her head out the door and says, "George, get in here quick." So I went in there, and sure enough, the guy behind the counter was one of Laura's old boyfriends from back in high school. And so, you know, we had to, you know, do the autograph thing and the back slap thing, you know, and my thing. And so we climb back up in the truck, and we're driving down the road, and I start chuckling. She looks over at me and says, "What?" And I said, "Laura, think about it. If you'd have married that guy, you'd be working here." She didn't miss a beat. She said, "George, if I'd have married him, he'd have been president." I noticed that the ladies laughed a lot louder. But you know what? Deanna, you are an awesome helpmate to this wonderful young Pastor Brian. And if it weren't for the ladies of this church and the ladies of this town, this town would not be what it is. So, gentlemen, let's do a tribute, first of all, to the ladies of Cortland. Oh, yes. And secondly, I want to thank those who serve Cortland's community as first responders, her EMTs, her firefighters, and yes, Cortland's finest, represented here, Cortland Police Department. And also, I want to add into that mix her ministers, because they put themselves out. They are available 24/7. They are tireless workers, as are all of these wonderful other first responders, many of whom, I'm sure, answered the call when New York City fell in that catastrophic day. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's let these guys know how much we love them and how much we appreciate them. Serve this nation in our military. Would you please rise and allow us to honor you tonight? Our veterans, please stand to your feet. Those that do serve, that are serving or have served. Expect you, because I want you guys to know I am in no hurry tonight. And when we are done, I've got the American flag sitting right over here, and I'd love to be willing and am willing to get a picture with each and every one of you. And we're going to have some kind of, you know, round and round circle thing. You know? So everybody get a picture. It won't take but a few minutes. So I'd ask you if you'd like it to stay and let me hug your neck and shake your hand and say hello. And what an honor it is to do it, especially for our troops here tonight, our veterans. You know, there's over 20 million vets in America, then we owe them our lives. We owe you our lives. So again, thank you so, so very much. You know, it reminds me of when I flew Air Force One into the Green Zone. It was this time of year, Thanksgiving, 2003. And I wanted to go there and, you know, thank the troops to, you know, eat a little turkey with the boys and to prove to the world that America does not have arachnophobia. And it looks like that time is upon us again. And, you know, President Obama just issued another 1,500 troops over there, and I couldn't help but chuckle. I sent him a letter with a single letter. See? Now, you know I'm kidding. We're actually all on the same team, working for the same goals, with the same cause, and the same purpose, and the same mission. And so it's an honor. So we flew Air Force One over there, and you know, God was working with us because the weather was perfect. It was a moonless night, which is what we needed, you know, because we flew in there under the cover of complete darkness. No running lights, no landing lights. I mean, we had to feel our way in. I won't say we hit anything when landed, but Laura and I got brand new camel hair coats out of the deal. Oh, speaking of animal clothing, I just picked these up today. What do you think? My new boots.
Ooh.
Yes. Aren't they nice? Yeah. No ostriches were harmed in the making of these boots. They were harmed before the making of them. And the weird thing is, Cheney was aiming at a deer. Oh, so much fun. Such an opportunity. Such a mission. This land, our lives, were so important. Each and every one of us is so important. Each one of us has the opportunity to affect, to influence, and to change the lives of the people around us. And the illustration that, you know, that I like to draw upon is, you know, people say, oh, I'm not important. Oh, yes, you are. It's kind of like, if you think you're not an influencer, then take a pebble or a stone and drop it into a glassy pond and try to keep it from making ripples. You can't. Ripples happen, and so does influence. Whatever we do affects everything else that's ever been done and everything that will be done. Decisions cannot be unmade once the actions have been put into place. And so the decisions that we make are so important. You know, should I run, should I not? There was a time when it was on the edge of a knife. And had I not chosen to run, the world would be a different place. I can't say whether it would be better or worse. That's in God's hands. But I'm saying that the decisions we make, we must make with seriousness. And so I wanna just kind of do a little cheerleading. You know, when I was in college, I was a cheerleader. I don't know if y'all know that. I still am. You know, I'm America's cheerleader. You know, I believe in that that simple message that good is better than bad.
Yes.
That freedom is better than bondage, and that right is better than left. Did I say that?
Yeah.
I mean wrong. But I want you to say this after me. Courage.
Courage.
Communication.
Communication.
Character.
Character.
I call those the four C's of leadership. Hey. It takes a lot of courage to do what I did. Run the country, fight terrorists, be anywhere close to Dick Cheney. Yeah, you know what we call this in Washington? The Cheney reaction. So, somebody stuck a little sticker on the limo one day that said, Dub Dub loose, Cheney's loose. But each and every one of us are influencers. And you want to be making decisions based on the best set of information. And I'm telling you, the best decision-making guide that exists is the Bible.
Amen.
And so if you're not in a good church, I recommend this one. I've gotten to know this man, Brian Havens, for quite some time now, and I couldn't recommend him more highly as a potential man with whom you can trust your life and place your family. And then so you got to lead by your values. And sometimes people don't think it's such a good idea. You know, I made a lot of decisions. People are like, what? And but it's all right. It made me tough. I've got thick skin, man. Like an elephant, which is the symbol of the Republican Party. My Democratic brothers and sisters here today are depicted as donkeys. Whereas my friends to the south call you burritos. So, the second C is communication. Don't misunderestimate. Communication is the most important part of talking. And hey, I've studied the studies. And good communication is only about 15% verbal, which in my case is a good thing, Mr. Mayor. But I have you know I am fluent in over 9 different body languages, some of which I had to abandon when I got saved. But when you're bilingual, as I am, you got to be careful to use the words you mean to use with carefully. Or you can create an international incident, as we learned recently during a trip to Krakistan. There's a big difference between saying I want a cracker and I am a cracker. So, the third C, character. Character. And I know all y'all know what I mean by character. Integrity, morality, traditional family values. Well, I've had the privilege of seeing the character of people up close, here and around the world, as well as abroad. And there's no more generous people. There's no more self-sacrificing people. There's no people more quick to give up themselves for their fellow man than right here in the good old U.S. of A. I've flown Air Force One into the largest cities and Marine One into many smaller towns and villages. I've slept in Buckingham Palace. I've watched the sunrise over Jerusalem. And I've feasted in the deserts of Abu Dhabi. I like that word, ma'am. It's fun to say. Abu Dhabi. It's like a son of Dhabi, I think it means. But it's got a funny sound. It's like a Abu Dhabi. Reminds me of Bibbidi Bobbidi. Where was I?
Abu Dhabi.
Well, to capsize what I'm trying to say, America is full of generous men and women with great character. And I want to continue to be an influencer. You know, someone that moves the needle in the right direction. I want to make my ripples count for good stuff. And so I've been, you know, asking myself, well, what is it that moves people? And you know, Brian, you know what I found out? Music is powerful. I mean, that video you played for me earlier was just wonderful. And we've all got songs that we've learned when we're younger. And you know, when they come on the radio, you kind of turn it up a little and takes you right back to where you were when you first learned it. And then there's great hymns and anthems. There's great American songs like, help me out with this one. Oh, say, can you see? See? By the way, that was the fourth C. Yeah, I like the letter C because it's also a word. I see you. Which is a whole letter made up of whole sentence made up of just 3 letters. That's communication is a weird thing. It's amazing what you can do with it. So anyway, so I like the letter C, but the letter D is my favorite. You know why? I know you know why. Because it's the first letter in the word W. With your decision making. Don't just do stuff. Figure out why first. You know, it's a good letter. Good word. You know, it's weird, the letter Y, the word Y starts with W and starts with a D. You see? Oh, man. So, where was I going with all this? Oh, yeah. I've been taking guitar lessons. From Willie Nelson. Hey, he's legal in Colorado. And I actually brought my guitar. By the way, how about that band that was up here? Let's have another round. Well, I hate to try to follow him, but I brought my guitar. Y'all want to hear a song? I picked an out of the way kind of a small church is because I'm new at this guitar thing. And I was hoping there wouldn't be any national press here. Okay, I gotta reach in here. This is my where I keep my pick. I call it my pickpocket. I love this crowd because if they'll laugh at that, they'll laugh at me. All right, I'm up to two strings now, so let's see how it goes. Gotta remember how the rest of it goes. You know, the problem is the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing. That'll go over some of y'all's heads, but my faith-based peeps know that's biblical. All right, here we go. Glad you got some water, man, because you look like you need it.
You sure it's water?
Well, I'm the free world leader. Freedom rolling out to you. George W. Bush. I pulled the wool over your eyes. But I've done it for a very good reason. My name is John Morgan, and I'm America's George Bush impersonator. And it's a pleasure to meet you. Thank you so much. When somebody first asked me if I would consider becoming a George Bush impersonator, I already knew I looked like George W. because I'd already heard every version of the question, has anybody ever told you that you look a lot like? And I thought that was cool. Hey, it's a lot of fun. But when they asked me if I wanted to step into the weird zone, I was quick to say no thanks. I didn't want to mess with my little box, my little life, you know? I had a job, I went to church, I served on the worship team at church, and I had this fear of what people might think of me if I chose to become a George Bush impersonator. But for one thing, I didn't know if I'd be any good at it. Yeah, obviously I am. I don't mind acknowledging the great gift that God has given me. I don't take credit for it because apart from Him, I don't take the next breath. I didn't make this face. You know, God did. So I know who, as Mrs. Robinson told me younger when I was a young man, honey, I know who pushes my swing. And I know who pushes my swing. So I'll acknowledge that He's given me a wonderful gift. And I will have fun with it. I love to sneak into the wax museum. And just stand there. And wait for some victim to come get a picture, you know? And then I just go, it's so fun. And when you mess with people's reality, like I just did with all of y'all. You know, when I first came in, some of you figured it out right away, but I mean, these guys look totally off. Let's have one more hand for these guys. In fact, if you guys would like, you're welcome to come take a seat now, because the jig is up. Part of the message is meant to inspire you, because I hope that my decisions will inform your future decisions. One day I was in the lobby of a hotel, and I had one of those little nudges from the Holy Spirit. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, have you ever had a time when you were mowing your lawn or driving your car and you saw someone or you saw something out of the ordinary, and this little suggestion came to your consciousness to get involved and to go and help? That was probably God trying to use you to be His representative for that person. And if you're not a Christian, then maybe it was just your own humanity. But if you're a believer, see, we're called in the Bible the body of Christ.
Amen.
And there's a reason for that. He's not here to go and talk to the woman at the well. But, wait. He is here in each and every one of us. And He wants to continue the work that He began 2,000 years ago through His church. And that's how it works. He puts these little nudges in your ear. And we have the opportunity to serve our fellow man. And that's how it happened in 9/11. God put a lot of nudges into a lot of men's ears and hearts, and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people came and just stopped their lives and brought their shovels and started digging. And one day I was in the lobby of a hotel, and there was this handicapped fellow there, and I got one of those little nudges. John, reach out to him because he can't play volleyball. That's how the thought came to my mind. And I didn't want to do it because I wanted to play volleyball, you know. He was handicapped. He walked with a walker. He had been in a bicycle accident, David Dollinger. But I reached out to him, and it was really cool. The second day we were there at the beach, he introduced me to my wife.
Wow.
You see, usually when those little nudges come, we're very quick, in one ear and out the other, and we just don't even consider them. We just let them go. Never even think, maybe it's God. But oh my, had I let that one go, I would have let that one go. Honey, would you stand up and wave at everybody? It's my wife. You see, Kathy had one of those little nudges, and she brought David to church the week before. And that's how he wound up in the lobby of that hotel. And we don't know what's going on. There's so much going on behind the scenes. None of us can see an atom or a molecule, but we know they exist. None of us can see, you know, the angels that are right here in this room, but they're here. And God has plans and he has purpose. And those little nudges that come along, they're designed for our good. And God, the Bible says, God is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. And so he is looking to give us things. He's looking to bless us. And see, it's the other guy that throws fear up in our face. Oh, I can't do that because. And some lame brain excuse. You know what I'm talking about? You ever had one of those things where you want to say something nice to somebody and then you talk yourself right out of it because of some stupid fear that doesn't even make sense? Happens all the time. Have I got the right crowd? Can y'all relate to what I'm saying? Okay, cool. So, do you want to become a George Bush impersonator? No way, that's the stupidest thing I ever heard. Folks, I've been in front of a couple of billion people at once singing an Elvis song as George W. Bush in China. At the end of which I said, God bless you. And I've had the privilege of sharing the gospel and sharing good American values all around the world. I mean, who knew? I had no clue what was waiting. How many of you ever heard of that game, Let's Make a Deal?
Yeah.
I think Drew Carey's hosting it now somewhere. But, they come along, they give you some money. And then they say, now wait, if you want to, I'll trade you that money for the box down on the floor. And there's Carol Merrill just standing there waiting, you know. She's 90 years old, but she's still waiting. And you've seen the show, so you know it could be a new car. Or it could be a goat with a little cowbell. And you're not thirsty for milk. You know, so when those nudges come, we wonder, is God going to give me a goat or a car? Well, I'm here to tell you, God loves you and will always only do good for you. Always only. It is the enemy who slanders him, who libels him, and feeds you all of these excuses and reasons not to take that risk. And I'm going to end my season here with my wonderful new friends in Cortland with a song that I wrote about a verse that lays this out better than anything I've ever seen. It's John, it's the Gospel of John, chapter 10, verse 10. So it's easy to remember, 10, 10. Well, you need to get your toes in it too. 10, 10 says, the thief comes to kill and steal and destroy, but I have come that they might have life and have it to the full. Well, golly, is your Christian experience full and adventurous and lively? Well, if not, maybe the thief is stealing from you by convincing you that maybe God's not as good as he claims he is. Let me play this song for you. Because see, what God did was he sent his very, very best. First of all, he created you and the world. And then he sent his son, his only begotten son, as our representative to die on the cross. And when he died on the cross, it wasn't just because it happened. It was intentional. He knew that he had come to give his life as a ransom for you and I before he was ever even on the earth. because it was prophesied from the very beginning of the Bible that that would happen. So it's really fascinating. I mean, it's the greatest romance in the history of the world. God's love for you and God's love for me. But then there's the villain, old Slewfoot, the enemy, who's just trying to mess up the works. If he can keep you away from God, then he wins. At least he wins you. And there's an eternal torment waiting for those that die without Christ. But if you are already a believer, then he wants to render you ineffective so that the ripples are not God good stuff. So anyway, so here's the song. Double glass doors and a guard standing there looking all tough like you guys. And I thought, well, it's either going to work or it isn't. And I just looked at him, I nodded, opened the door, and walked right in. He didn't even move. He was frozen. You know, what do I do? So funny. So I really hope that you'll get this. Now, I have a caveat for you. I only have 20 copies. So not everybody's going to get one, and they're only $15. So for the first 20 of you that want one, come get it. And for the rest of you, sorry. But I also brought a DVD of a performance just like this. And there's even more songs and some fun stuff on there that you didn't get to enjoy in this particular performance, such as the front of the stage was lined with greenery. And I said to the folks, I'd like to introduce you to the rest of my family. Just some of the bushes. I guess you had to be there. In the moment, it was hilarious. When you see it on the DVD, you'll love it. But I only brought 5 of those. And the reason is because I'm traveling, and that's just all I have left. So I'm hoping you guys will clean me out tonight. And it's got all kinds of pictures. Oh, and Governor Huckabee, Mike Huckabee, wrote the foreword to the book, too. He's a friend of mine. So thank you. Please buy those out and bring them right over here, because I will autograph them for you. My beautiful bride, Kathy's going to be down front. And so in closing tonight, and I'm going to give it back to Brian for closing prayer and benediction. In fact, let me just do that. Brian, let me turn it back over to you.
Go ahead and give John a round of applause, please. And I think it was the son of Dobby, you know? So anyways, and you only have 19 of each left. We're going to have some things that go on before I close this prayer. I just want to let you know. If you want to come up and get an autograph, get a picture with John, and you want to get a book signed, let's kind of go in this circle here. John would be here by our American flag. And then if you choose to get a book, you can do so in that manner. While you're in line, we're going to call about 17 or 18 tickets for those of you who might have won one of our giveaways in the back table. So I'll call those out once we finish while you're in line, if you choose to get a picture. With that, thank you for coming this evening to celebrate with us. It's a wonderful day, and I thank all of you. Veterans and Americans are the backbone of our nation, and my heart goes out to you. So let us close in prayer after this great celebration. I want to remind you that tomorrow, this isn't the only thing we're celebrating. Tomorrow, our construction season begins on our church, and Drew Phelps Construction is going to be doing that, so thank you, Drew. And second, let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for such a wonderful night, for wonderful entertainment, and a wonderful guest in John. Bless all these people that have come and protect them as they leave. Lord, I thank you that they've been able to be blessed by this. We're here for our community and here to support them through you. May this evening touch the hearts and the lives of not only the people here, but our entire community. Let us live the love of Jesus through them and protect our guests as he leaves as well. In Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. I also want to let you know, tonight, our official new website is being launched. So if you're interested in checking that out, go ahead and check that out. Funkin' Jackson Group has done that for us, and
what's it called?
It is crownalliance.church. Did I get that right? Crownalliance.church. So go check that out. Service times are on there as well. Thank you very much. You're dismissed.